Welcome back. In this second session, we will look at network building blocks. Now, this section aims to describe the key building blocks that make up today's modern communication systems. It will provide some insight into new technologies and trends related to building communication systems, and it will identify some of the policy considerations that are relevant to building these communication systems. Now, just a note here. In this session, I would request that you also look at the printed manual or the electronic version of it, because in that there is a whole set of information on these actual building blocks. So in this video session, I will not actually describe those particular building blocks, which are things like, you know, what are air stations, what are customer premises equipment, what switches and routers do, and so on. I would request that you read that from the manual itself, because it's perhaps a bit easier in that manner. What I will concentrate on here is describing some of the larger technology issues around building communication systems, and then perhaps talking a little bit about some of the policy perspectives that we need to look at. A couple of facts. One, we know that technology is rapidly evolving. Now, usually the developed world quickly adopts to new and emerging technologies, and often the challenge for the developing world is that if we are not up to date with technology, particularly our users, that is, really have to cope with these changes, usually with minimal resources. So in other words, we really don't have the facilities and features available that perhaps the developed world has. So what do? Well, we can either adopt very quickly, or maybe we miss out completely. Now, what does that mean? That means that, you know, we've just increased the digital divide. You know, so there's that word digital divide back here again. So let me ask you a question. In your opinion, does the average user in your country have enough bandwidth? In other words, is there sufficient internet speed for the typical user to be able to use voice over IP? In other words, to use the internet to make telephone calls? Is that sufficient? Second part of the question. How about watching a video broadcast on the internet? Can you watch a television station or, you know, a website like YouTube, which is becoming very, very popular these days around the world? Can you actually watch and view this using your internet connection? A lot of people will say, I guess not. No, we have issues. It's too slow. Or it's too expensive. So, you know, these are issues that we need to consider when it comes to not only deploying technology, but where are we headed with that technology? Now, if we look at actual communications infrastructure or ICT infrastructure, core ICT infrastructure includes a reliable backbone which interconnects various parts of the network, and of course then that connects to other parts of the network. Now, for any two systems to connect to each other or to communicate with each other, there needs to be something in between. We call that the connectivity medium. Now, usually, well, in the old days, I keep on saying the old days, but sometimes the old days was not that too long ago, usually copper cable was used to be the connectivity medium between two systems. However, in today's age, optical fiber is the medium of choice. A couple of reasons for this. Number one, it offers far greater bandwidth. So when we say bandwidth, we mean the capacity it has to carry information. It is also resilient to what we call electromagnetic interference. Now, as you perhaps may be aware, that when you have a copper-based cable, and once you run a signal across it, it actually creates what we call an electric field and a magnetic field. Now, if you have two similar cables running next to each other, there is the potential that they could interfere with each other. And this interference is actually caused by what we call this electromagnetic interference. It just doesn't stop there. If you have, you know, a large power transformer or some sort of large machinery, a lot of very high-intensity lights, or say tube lights and things of that sort, all these can actually create what you call electronic noise or electric noise, which can affect the transmission of communications signals over a cable. And so for this very reason, you know, a lot of steps are taken to actually try and protect communications cables from interference, you know. We use shielding, we earth it, and so on and so forth. The advantage with optical cables is that they actually use light to transmit information rather than electrical signals as copper cables do. So that's where the advantage of optical cable comes in. However, of course, there is an issue with optical cables in the sense that they're not cheap to deploy. They are expensive. They need to be installed in a particular manner, and they need certain resources around them to be installed and deployed quickly, efficiently, and so that they work properly. However, but optical cable is the medium of choice today because it is, you know, the characteristics it has far outweigh whatever cost issues that arise. And particularly if you're connecting a backbone type network, so connecting one network to another network, optical cable is your medium of choice in that regard. There is a need for governments to invest in reliable national infrastructure and to explore regional network options for international redundancy. Now, usually what we see is that urban centers are, what we say, they're pretty well connected. But sometimes, if a country has, let's say, three or four large urban centers, there's a need to have connectivity between these urban centers, so from one center to another, city to city, town to town, and so on. And really, what's needed here is a national optical backbone, perhaps. A lot of countries have started deploying a national fiber optic backbone, which connects all major parts of the country up. And, you know, in this way, you are actually future-proofing your investment, because as the country develops, you know, as more users come online, more villages and communities get connected up, having a national backbone in place is very useful, because you don't have to go to the added expense of spending more money in connecting these centers up, and you have interconnectivity between your main urban centers as well as emerging rural centers, perhaps. Reliable local ICT infrastructure and good international connectivity are also the foundations for attracting ICT-based business investors. A lot of economists are now saying that, you know, we want to be an ICT-based economy. We want to transform ourselves. We want to attract ICT-based businesses. But to attract those businesses and those investors, you really need to have a suitable infrastructure in place. Because when these investors come into the country, the first thing they'll ask is, you know, what's your infrastructure? What's your international connectivity? Will I have reliable power? Will I have reliable communication links? You know, quite apart from, of course, you know, things like human capital, security of premises, and so on. So it is very critical that suitable ICT infrastructure is deployed and installed, and of course maintained and operated, so that investors, and not just investors, of course, the general community and the general public in particular, are able to make efficient use of these services which may flow across them. Now, once infrastructure exists nationally, there's also the need to connect overseas or to offshore locations, because, you know, a network, you can only communicate if we are all interconnected around the world. So one very important aspect to look at is, you know, how does my country connect to the rest of the world? It's very true that when we talk about the world in general, we start talking about regions and sub-regions. And more often than not, sub-regions of the world have some sort of connection between them, where they know there's exchange of information, there's perhaps business opportunities across two neighboring countries and so on. So in that regard, there is some need, perhaps, that we should have a regional or a sub-regional cable network in place. So let's say there are five or six countries which have a lot of trade in between them. There is perhaps a case where you could say it is feasible to have a cable running across these countries, so that there are potential savings in using international bandwidth. So if you don't have a connectivity between neighboring countries, as an example, then each country would have to go to an offshore location somewhere. And then from that location, it would have to come back in again to connect to the next country. But if the cable is running across the country to the next country, there could be some savings cost-wise. And of course, you could perhaps have larger information capacity in that manner. Now, an example of such a regional cable system is what we call the Southeast Asia, Middle East, and West Europe cable system. Now, this stretches from Western Europe across and through the Middle East, on the top of North Africa, through the Middle East, and into South Asia and Southeast Asia. And you know, if you look at the slide which you have on this cable, it shows it stretching, you know, covering a vast part of the world, and this vast part of the world has a vast population base as well as a very strong economic base. You have Western Europe, you have Northern Africa, the Middle East, and Asia, or parts of Asia, which of course are all strong economies, or are recognizes strong economies where businesses want to have a presence, and they of course also have very large population bases in and around these areas. So this cable system of course has brought down the costs of communications access. It's also provided redundancy options. So these countries, this is not the only cable running into these countries, they also have alternative cable paths. So there's redundancy. If one cable fails, they can hopefully switch to another cable so that connectivity remains for the country. So it's very important to have international redundancy as well as local redundancy. Now, quite apart from optical fiber, sometimes it might not be feasible to deploy optical fiber. Now, there can be many reasons for this, but primarily they have to do with terrain issues. There may be environmental factors. It may be too hot, too cold. In terms of terrain, you know, it may be you're looking at mountains or valleys or, you know, snow, lots of snow around perhaps, rivers and so on. So, you know, with all these factors, deployment costs become a major issue. If you're running optical fiber cable, as we were talking about before, you know, the optical fiber cable needs to be installed. That means, you know, a ditch has to be dug, conduits have to be run, people have to be physically working to make that cable installation take place. And therefore, you know, deployment costs can be quite substantive. So if we look at wireless technology then, it does away with a lot of these deployment issues, you know, where terrain and environmental factors are of less impact. Wireless can be an option for point-to-point as well as what we call multi-point connectivity or point-to-multi-point. So point-to-point would be to connect up two, let's say, two towns or two villages together. And point-to-multi-point would be, you know, where you have one village, which perhaps may be centrally located, which acts as a hub to connect all the villages and communities around it. In a multipoint situation, of course, wireless allows a very highly dispersed coverage, and perhaps the best example of this is a mobile phone tower. You install a mobile phone tower, and immediately all the area around it has got coverage. Now, if you try to do that using a cable-based system, be it optical cable or copper-based cable, you know, you'd have to install quite a bit of cable to ensure that everyone around that area is actually connected up. So that's where the business case for wireless comes about, where it is, you know, a very, very feasible option to look at. So there needs to be a balance made, of course. What people usually do is that wireless base stations which are installed, if possible, there's an optical cable running between the base stations, and then the base stations themselves give wireless coverage around their local area. However, sometimes it's not possible to run optical cable between these wireless base stations, so a point-to-point wireless link is made between the two. So, you know, ultimately it's a decision based on what is appropriate. So, you know, that term appropriate technology, again, it's very important to consider what appropriate technology is for the scenario we're in. But at the same time, you must keep in mind that you need to future-proof the network. You need to look at how the network is going to grow, and you need to be able to ensure that whatever systems you put in place are actually scalable, and they will actually grow with the system and user demand. Let's now look at the user perspective. So the question is, what does the typical internet user want? Well, the typical user or the typical internet user is not really interested in regional and international optical cable. They're not interested in whether they have wireless delivery or where they are wireless backbones or optical backbones and all this other technical mumbo-jumbo. What they're interested in is being able to afford and use the services. So one, it's got to be fast enough and it's got to be cheap enough. So yet again another question. In your country or where you live, is there just one telecommunications provider or are there many? In other words, do you have competition? Does that competition exist in landlines, mobile phones, internet service providers? Does it cover everyone or does it only cover certain parts of the telecommunication sector? How many ISPs do you have? Are their pricing plans the same? Are they different? What differentiates one from the other? So these are questions that the user would typically ask. And usually we say that, you know, if you have competition, more often than not, competition will lead to a reduction in prices and an increase in the quality of service that is being delivered. So, you know, we've looked at a few things in and around communication systems. We've discussed some concepts very briefly. And again, I refer you back to the manual itself for further information on the bits that make up these communication systems. But let us now just look at some policy considerations that we need to keep in mind when we are talking about communication systems. Now, the first thing to keep in mind is that one, there is a need to future-proof infrastructure. And we need to use appropriate technology, for example, deploying optical fiber networks instead of copper-based networks for critical backbone connections. Now, also keep in mind that it is far easier to tap a copper cable than it is to tap an optical cable. So there's also a security perspective to optical cable. Now, usually if you want to tap an optical cable, someone actually has to break into the cable. Now, if that happens, the cable signals will be lost at least for a short period of time. So it's usually possible to detect a break in the cable and then try and find out why there was a break in the cable. But with a copper cable, it is actually possible to just tap into the cable without a break in communications or a very visible break in communications. So there's a security perspective to this as well here. There's a need to explore the possibility of regional and sub-regional cable networks and to aid in system redundancy and stability, because having cables and systems are fine, but of course you also need to have redundancy in place. There needs to be stability. You need to ensure that systems keep on running, that there's no one single point of failure in the network, particularly if you're talking to the outside world. Now, just on this point, I'd also just like to highlight here that redundancy also means that you don't have redundancy at the same location. It's useless having two cables in the same building. You need to have what we call geographical redundancy as well. So you need to have landing points perhaps in different parts of the country. At the same time, you should also have service provider redundancy. That means whoever is providing you with the international bandwidth, yes, you go with provider A, but for your second redundant link, you go with provider B, because the provider's systems can also go down. So there's also an important consideration there. You need to assess the benefits a robust national cable infrastructure could provide. And more and more, it is very critical that an economy, a country, has a national backbone infrastructure in place so that, you know, as the population base grows, as technology evolves, they're able to scale and provision these services. In the internet service provision space, there is a need to ensure that there's a level playing field, particularly when it comes to customer premises equipment, and of course at the wholesale and international gateway service. Now, if you have only one international gateway, then really there is no competition on your international part of your communication system. There is perhaps competition at the retail end, which means the international gateway would sell at a wholesale level to, say, three or four providers. But ultimately, the pricing would be controlled by the international gateway, because each of the retail providers would put a margin or a markup on their wholesale costs from the international gateway and then provide that on to the customer. So having competition at the international gateway level is important, because then it keeps both of them honest, assuming there's only two of them. But of course, if you have more, it'll keep everyone honest. And, you know, again, that old adage still applies, that if you have competition, more likely than not, more often than not, you will have a reduction in prices and an improvement in the quality of service. Because if you have a choice, if you don't like someone, you can move to the next guy. In situations where terrain and deployment costs hamper service provision using cable-based systems, it's very feasible to consider the use of wireless systems and, or of course, satellite-based systems, which can deliver these connectivity to you. However, you need to ensure there's a fair regulatory mechanism in place which will allow feasible delivery of services. Let's say you have a situation where a telecom service provider is not able to provide a type of service to a community, to a particular location. Perhaps there are not enough subscribers in that location, it's too far away, the costs to deploy services there would be very restrictive to the telecom operator, because obviously a telecom operator also needs to make money. We also need to keep that in mind. It may be more, well, it has to be a commercial operation. It has to make money. So it's very important to ensure that there is a fair regulatory mechanism in place so that If the telecom provider cannot provision the service, the regulations must allow an alternative form of connectivity for that location. So that's something that, you know, policymakers and regulators should really look hard at to see, you know, how best can we ensure that all parts of the community, all parts of society in our country have equitable access or the provision of equitable access to services.